Welcome to r/ProRevenge. This is a story of someone getting back at someone with pro revenge after being wronged. And today's story is, AT&T tries to screw me over $139. I actually screw them out of $72,000. After my wife and I got married last year, we decided that we should both get on the same phone plan. We went down to the AT&T store and met with a rep who told us we'd both be on an unlimited plan for $70 a month all in, including taxes and fees. I was very specific about getting the all-in price for the service. It seemed like a decent deal, so we signed up. 2 days later, I log into the website and see that there's already a bill for $139. I call up a rep to see what's up, and they tell me that between the activation fees, taxes, and surcharges, the bill was correct. I told them what the salesperson told me, and they basically told me to pound sand. I promptly told them I wanted to cancel the service, and we wanted the $139 waived. They said they could cancel the service, but could not or would not waive the bill. They also told me if I canceled immediately, my wife and I would lose our phone numbers, which is true. So I figure since I already have to pay for the month, and I don't want to lose my phone number, I'll just get a new carrier and cancel when I'm ready. So I do my research and find Visible, which is excellent, and we make the switch. I call back to AT&T and inform them that we have switched carriers and we want to cancel the service. I again ask for a refund. The rep informs me that since I've had the service for 4 days, that I'm not entitled to a refund. He tells me to read the fine print on the contract, which indeed tells me that I have 3 days to cancel for a full refund. I'm now fuming, because the first CSR that I talked to on day two denied me a refund if I canceled. I ask for the next level of CSR, and they send me to a customer care and retention person. I explain the entire fiasco to him, and how I feel that I've now been lied to twice by AT&T reps, sales rep, and first CSR. He is a really cool guy and apologizes and says he'll take care of it and will completely waive the bill. I am very thankful and hang up thinking that this is finally resolved. Fast forward a month and I get an AT&T bill in the mail saying my payment was not received and is now late. I again pick up the phone and call AT&T. I eventually make my way through two CSR reps until I get back to the customer care and retention department. This time I did not have the chill dude. Instead, I got a very smarmy woman who said that the bill was due and I'd owe the entire amount. I asked her to please check the CSR notes and that the last guy told me he'd waive the amount. She put me on a 10-minute silent hold and came back and said she'd escalate the matter to her supervisor. She said I should receive an email by the end of the week with a resolution. 2 weeks go by, no response. I call again. This time I got a very nice lady that's sympathetic. She says she'll waive the bill. She comes back and tells me that she can't do anything because the bill has already been sent to collections. She said not to worry and that she'll send a letter to collections to have them waive the debt. I ask if this will go on my credit report and she says no, and that they'll take care of it. 6 months later, I get a letter in the mail from Sequium Asset Solutions, out of Georgia, trying to collect on the $139. I immediately send them a letter via certified mail, demanding that they verify the debt, since it's obviously bad. I hear nothing for 2 months, and then I get an alert that I have a negative mark on my credit. I go in and sure enough, Sequium has indicated the amount is in collections. I immediately write letters to all three bureaus requesting that they remove the mark. A month goes by, and every single one of the bureaus removes the mark. Thank God. Another 3 months go by, and then I get a letter from Sunrise Credit Services in New York, again trying to collect on the debt. This is truly unbelievable, because it appears that Sequium couldn't verify it, so instead of apologizing and waiving the debt, they sold it off to another collection agency. I send another certified letter to Sunrise demanding verification. I get nothing in reply. So far, they've not attempted to put a mark on my credit. That's where this part of the story ends. Who knows what will happen next? I could file a lawsuit, but the filing fee alone would be more than the amount owed. Here's the thing, I'm not cash strapped. I'm blessed enough that I could easily pay the $139 without making a dent in my budget. I've lost 5 times that amount in hours spent on the phone and writing letters, but I'm determined to go to the mat with AT&T on principle alone. This brings us to the revenge stage. You see, in addition to my day job as an attorney, I'm an elected city councilman in my town, and when I was going over our monthly expenses, I noticed that we were paying AT&T close to $6,000 a month for our phones, internet, and TV services. We're a fairly small town, so it was pretty obvious that we were being bent over by these clowns and that we could save a ton of money by switching. I started working with our city manager and IT director on finding other solutions. We discovered that by switching to various carriers and providers that we could save half. I never would have looked that closely into our telecom expense had AT&T not jerked me around. 2 weeks ago, the resolution to switch was put on our meeting agenda and the council voted to pass it. We decided to completely cut ties with AT&T. Our city is saving a ton of money, getting better service, and with the money we saved from switching, we were able to hire another part-time animal shelter employee, which we desperately needed. I highly doubt our city would have considered switching if I didn't make such a stink about it. AT&T will end up losing hundreds of thousands over the coming years because of this. I hope it was worth it, AT&T. The second story is, read your D emails, Karen. I used to work in an office. What kind of work isn't particularly important to the story, so just picture a basic office job. Every January, HR would send an email to all employees with the employee handbook. This included job descriptions, office policies, etc. Every year since the PDF handbook had been established, it would be named with the year following it to establish it was different than the original and all other years. Any changes would have updated next to the section in the table of contents, so you could see what had changed from the previous year and familiarize yourself with anything new. Now with that background, we'll introduce Karen. Karen had been with the company a pretty long time, about 10 years I believe. She was fine at her job, just fine. She would get things done, but not without making everyone else miserable in the process. She would ask questions that had already been answered and basically just waste everyone's time for fun. She was just plain nasty to people and tried as hard as she could to make everyone stay far away from her. The worst thing about her was she always seemed to be looking for a fight or looking for a reason to complain. She had threatened lawsuits a few times over any small thing, but would always just get it over and drop it because she knew no laws had been broken and would never go anywhere. She'd comment on how she should sue basically every business she ever went to because she could live off the settlement and retire early. Over the smallest issues you can imagine. She did her job, and we never had a valid reason to fire her, especially knowing how lawsuit happy she was, so she stayed. Karen's job description, as per the handbook, called for a bachelor's degree. Karen did not have a bachelor's degree, but had been hired prior to that being a requirement, so she was grandfathered in. One day, a position above hers became open. A guy who we'll call Terry had recently completed his master's degree after taking night classes for a few years, and since an internal promotion is typically better than an outside hire, he was chosen for the promotion. Terry had been at the company about 4.5 years and was well-liked and great at his job. The new job required a master's degree in its job description, and him being a recent grad, it was a perfect fit, and everyone was happy for him. Everyone but Karen. Since she was constantly looking for something to sue about, she took it as a direct insult that she had not been considered for this promotion, that she was not at all qualified for. She immediately cried discrimination and told our boss her lawyer would be in touch. We were all perplexed. Since it was very clear that this position required a master's degree, and given that she didn't even have a bachelor's degree, there's no way she could have been hired for the role. What we soon realized was that Karen had saved the original company handbook, named Company Handbook, and had not bothered to open or save any new additions that were sent in the following 8 years. She just assumed no changes had been made, and that it was just sent every year to ensure all employees had it. If she's bothered to open the file, she would have seen the sections that say updated in the table of contents. Since Karen cried lawsuit a lot, no one expected much of this, since it was a ridiculous claim. But sure enough, Karen gives her resignation letter via email, and it is scathing, about how she can't bear to work in such a discriminatory environment that would only promote men. When any higher-ups try to speak to her about this and clear up the confusion, she basically tells them to F off and to read the D email. I don't know any more of an explanation. She basically goes full Karen. Not long after, a letter comes in from her lawyer, asking for a settlement to avoid a discrimination case. What Karen hadn't realized was that our boss's sister-in-law owned a law firm. She didn't really take on clients herself anymore, and mostly just managed the other lawyers of her firm. She was basically semi-retired. What this meant was she had plenty of time to review any letters from Karen's lawyer and advise us. Since Karen didn't bother to read any of the updated handbooks, she was unaware that this position had required a master's degree for many years now. I believe about 6 years. She supplied her lawyer with the original company handbook from 9 years ago, and he used that as reference in his settlement demand. This was when we realized that she hadn't read any new handbooks in years. Since Karen rubbed a lot of people the wrong way, boss's sister-in-law decided to personally take on the case. Every letter Karen's lawyer sent, she sent back one 3 times in length. Some of it wouldn't even really say anything, just wordiness, but it would certainly take Karen's lawyer a while to read it, and he did not come cheap. After several of these letters, they realized no settlement is going to happen. They want to take it to court. It's a pretty cut and dry case. Boss's sister-in-law shows evidence that Karen has received all updates via email. After the change was made and the handbook was sent out, HR even sent an email to Karen specifically letting her know that she was grandfathered in and doesn't need to worry. To which Karen replied, "Okay, thank you," confirming receipt of it. The best part was when boss's SIL said that they couldn't break company rules to give Karen a job she was totally unqualified for, while neglecting another employee who went above and beyond to get his master's degree to advance, as that would be unfair to all other employees. Karen now had a huge, seriously huge bill from her lawyer for all of these letters and filing the case, etc. No job, no one she could list as a positive recommendation, and no degree. In the time she'd been at the company, it had become industry standard to require a bachelor's degree, so she was effectively shut out of her career. It would also be hard to explain how you work somewhere for a decade and don't have a letter of recommendation from anyone there. If she had only read her D emails. The last story is, made an a-hole redo an entire school year. During the final trimester of my last year in high school, we had to do a group project that needed to be finished by the end of the trimester and was evaluated and graded in front of a jury of teachers instead of an exam. I was paired with the biggest D-bag in class. Imagine a really entitled, arrogant a-hole. Every time we were supposed to work on the project, he would have some excuse to not show up and demand I would work on it alone to make sure the project stayed on track. In the beginning, I tried to complain and talk to the teacher, but she would just say, "Make it work, it's your project." After a while, I stopped planning work meetings altogether. He would call me to ask how the project was going, and I would say something like, "Yeah, it's going well. I think it's almost finished, or I'll send you the presentation to prepare for the jury." Little did he know, I had a trump card in my hand. The project counted for 40% of the final grade. Me, doing well in the class, already got about 55 of the other 60%, so even if I got a zero on the project, I would still pass the class. The a-hole had less, a lot less. After it became clear he was just going to use my work to pass the class and the teacher didn't care, I decided to throw out all the work for the project and keep the a-hole in the dark. The last bit went a lot easier than I expected, as he was happy with me telling him everything was on track. In the last week before the jury presentation, things became harder. The a-hole wanted me to send the presentation, so he knew which part he had to present. I managed to stall a few days with excuses, but 2 days before the jury presentation, I finally sent him an email with the PowerPoint, which was actually an MP3 file with a changed file extension. The next day, I switched off my phone. In the evening, I called him back with the excuse my phone had issues, and he was panicking that there was something wrong with the PowerPoint. I told him not to worry, I'll check it out tonight and have a working PowerPoint for tomorrow. I would come to the school at 8 a.m., so he could practice his part of the presentation before the jury appointment at 9 a.m. The next morning, I arrived at school a little before 9 a.m., having switched off my phone again. When he saw me, he approached me with a mix of panic and anger, but before I could explain anything, we were called into the room with the jury for our presentation. I just told the a-hole not to worry and let me do the talking. We greeted the jury and I started the introduction. The original idea of today was for us to present our project XYZ, but since I already have enough points to pass this class, and Mr. A-hole over here couldn't be bothered to put in any effort, I decided to skip it and instead have a nice day off tomorrow. That concludes our presentation. Thank you for your attention. I just walked out on four confused teachers and one a-hole with a mouth open so wide, it looked like he was trying to eat a club sandwich vertically. Naturally, there was some backlash in the days after that. Teacher called for an explanation, but in the end recognized I was a good student, and I indeed already passed the class without the project. A-hole was angry that he had to study over the summer for a re-exam. All in all, I was happy to have graduated and look forward to going to college the next year. After the summer, I heard from friends that A-hole failed his re-exam, and that, combined with other bad grades, caused him to have to redo his last year. Karma is a B. Thank you for listening.